Okay, well, welcome everyone. Thanks for taking time out of your free time during the day or during the evening to come and see us. OWASP has their top 10 list, and number 9 on that top 10 list is a fairly simple one. That's don't use known vulnerable components in your software. There's a lot more words on the OWASP top 10 list that say that. But that's some of what I'm going to talk to you about this evening. So I'll take you back a little to May of this year. I went to the Velocity conference. I was standing in the elevator with one other guy, and that guy was from a healthcare-related IT company that makes software that goes in hospitals and medical devices and stuff like that. And I had just done this huge research project on what different companies were doing in the open source development space. And I said, you know, your company is a huge Java developer. He said, well, that's kind of strange. How did you know? I said, well, I had just done this research project and we got to talking and he said, yeah, I know we're using open source all over the place, but we don't really have any reins on how it's being used, how it's coming into the organization. You guys are a massive Java development shop, and as we were talking, I said, you know, I happen to have some data on what your company is doing in terms of Java. Because of where I work at Sonatype, and I'll tell you a little more about that, but his company was consuming 2.1 million open source components a year. They have 2,000 developers. And within those components, the great thing about that is they're able to accelerate their development incredibly fast. Their developers don't have to code from scratch. They can get components off of the internet, bring them into the company, put them in their applications, meet their time to market deadlines, and it's extremely productive for them. At the same time, out of those 2.1 million components, 108,000 were known vulnerable. One in 20 components that they were downloading from the internet, from public repositories, had known vulnerabilities. And the interesting thing, or scary thing, depending on what perspective you look at, developers are more productive. The security team's freaking out when they see this kind of information. But these guys are among the average for the organizations out there. So let me tell you a little bit about how I know this this research. So I work at Sonatype. Dalton also in the back works at Sonatype. Does anyone know who Sonatype is?
Yeah.
Couple of people in the room. So we are a very small business. We only have about 80 people, but we have a gigantic footprint in software development tools. In the Java space, we run something called the Central Repository. And that is the largest public repository of open source components for Java developers worldwide. And I will show you a lot of the stats that we gathered from that this evening. We also, our founder, Jason Van Ziel, created the Maven build tool that's used by about 8 million developers around the world to build their applications. We also have Nexus repository managers that are used to store open source and third-party components that are pulled from the internet or developed internally in your organizations. And with that, we have a great purview into what's happening in software development and how it actually works. So I wanted to share some of that with you tonight to give you some insight about what's really happening out there. Because for you and your organizations, it's a little more difficult for your organizations to see what we see as the central source of this information. So this kind of all revolves around, and to make it easier to understand, it all revolves around supply chains. And every modern manufacturing organization in the world has a supply chain. They have suppliers that build parts for them. If we pick auto manufacturers as an example, they have suppliers that build steering wheels and brakes and engine parts and other parts of the vehicle that they then build and they put in warehouses, and the auto manufacturers procure those, and they procure them and bring them into warehouses close to their factory floors. And when they need those parts to go in the products that they're producing and the cars that they're producing, they get them, put them in the cars, and then ship them to dealers or the end consumers. So these efforts by these manufacturers are the same whether you're a drug manufacturer, a food services manufacturer, a toy manufacturer, what have you. And there are best practices associated with doing that make these guys extremely efficient, where they can pick the best suppliers, the best quality parts, know exactly what parts they're putting into their products, and trace those throughout their software or their supply chain. So every single nut and bolt going into these vehicles, or every ingredient going into a drug, or every little toy wheel going onto a little toy car, or any ground beef going into the package of ground beef is traceable in some form or fashion. They know exactly what was used, who it came from, what it went into, and who it was distributed to. So similar to these modern supply chains in manufacturing, software development works the same way. Is the stewards of the central repository where all of these open source components exist that Sonotype manages, there are 106,000 organizations that develop software that pull software from these components from the central repository. 106,000 pulled from the repository last year. And from this, I actually spent about 2 months earlier this year analyzing this environment of the suppliers and the manufacturers and the developers and the consumption patterns and everything like that, because at Sonotype, there's all this folklore and myth when you work at Sonotype about what people are doing, and the stories like I shared from the elevator about this company downloading millions of components and hundreds of thousands of vulnerable components. And there are tons of these kind of stories, but none of them are documented outside the company. And so I said, I want to do this research to document the story, to share it with people, for the intention of not saying we're doing crappy work out there, or bad work, or there are developers doing really bad things that they shouldn't be doing, but to start a conversation on what is the state of affairs today, and if we see that state of affairs, being able to improve upon where we are in the current state. And because we have this unique perspective, we thought that we should share it with everyone, and I think you'll find that the information pretty eye-opening, in good and bad ways. So in the software supply chain, you have open source projects. All of you, or some of you, may even participate in building open source components. Developers in your organization may build these components. And if they want to make them available to the world of open source developers or developers using these components, they put them in these central warehouses. The central repository that we manage is the largest one, but there's the NuGet Gallery for .NET developers, RubyGems.org for RubyGems developers, and a host of other public large repositories that are serving these components to any developers that want them. They're free. You just connect your build tools, or just go and search on Safari and find the components you need, and you download them. And there are central warehouses. There are also local warehouses called repository managers, where companies say, "Yeah, I just don't want to source all of my parts from the internet. I want to store parts closer to my factories where we're developing software, or closer to our developers." Yes.
GitHub is the repository?
So GitHub is a similar kind of thing where people have code that they can share, but it's more custom code than kind of open source components and
maintenance. Basically. Yeah, like a maven build, basically.
Yeah, so the Maven build kinds of things where you're packaging the binaries or frameworks for reuse that are standard components go into these central repositories. So the local warehouses are also actively in use, and we'll talk about some of that. The manufacturing, the software development teams that you have consume these components, and they turn them into software applications as finished goods. The software supply chains that your organizations have behave in the same manner, or have the same structure, I should say, as modern supply chains in any industry. But there are significant differences. Right? The way that we organize and operate and our practices around software development has not changed significantly from when we used to write all of our code from scratch. And the processes, while software development has changed, the processes around it have not changed enough. And as security professionals, this will come and should come as an even bigger wake-up call than the OWASP A9 part of the top 10 list, or give you a better understanding as we go through the data as to why this is in the why that element is in the top 10 list. Part of what's pushing the development is it's not only getting faster and more efficient to develop software using these open source and third-party components, but it's allowing people to meet faster time to market and time to release schedules, where there are efforts out there, continuous delivery, continuous integration, DevOps efforts that are working towards speeding releases toward continuous. Where organizations, I saw the leading parts of these organizations, Amazon is now doing 1,000 releases a day. On average, they deploy those releases to 10,000 sites simultaneously, and at peak, they do 30,000 sites simultaneously. The volume and velocity of what the newer development practices are heading toward are extremely fast and supported by these software supply chains and the tool chains that support them working extremely efficient. When you work at these high speeds and you're aiming toward that as a development organization, moving from waterfall to agile to continuous to the more DevOps practices, this is creating the winners and losers within the software development space. And Gene Kim, who wrote the Phoenix Project, if you want to learn about DevOps, download, go to Amazon or Kindle, get the Phoenix Project and read that book. But people like Nigel Simpson at Disney, John Willis at Docker, Gareth Rushgroves at Puppet Labs were helping me review the research that I wrote, and were saying we need to better recognize how we develop software in these software supply chains and recognize the benefits and the risks of doing this and understand how to make the practices more efficient. Last year, the central repository that we manage for the Java open source component served 17 billion download requests. In any industry anywhere in the world, 17 billion is a gigantic number, right? It's in many cases unfathomable, right? That is a lot. Now, even when iTunes does billions of things, that is a lot. The population that this serves is about 10 million people. There are only 10 million Java developers in the world. My mom is not downloading components from the central repository.
Are you sure?
Yes. It's never come up in a dinner conversation. She may be learning to code in her spare time. So this has an impact on the applications that we develop. Anyone want to take a guess on the average number or average percent of open source and third-party components in an application today?
C.
80% to 90%. I'll give you a card. Did you say C too? You said C. I knew it came from over here. Just email me at weeks@sonotype.com. I'll send you a Sonotype t-shirt. So C, because you got it right. So we see about 80 or 90% of what's in a modern application is open source and third-party components. This is, I don't have time to write the code myself. It exists out there on the internet. I want to utilize that component. It can help me meet my goals and productivity goals within the organization, and I'm going to bring that into the organization. It's extremely beneficial to software development to do this. And as you saw from the last chart, they're doing this more and more. And I'm sure if we did 17 billion downloads last year, that we'll do 20 plus billion this year, although I haven't heard what we're tracking for in this year. But like all modern manufacturing efforts in these supply chains, what you want to do is make sure that if you're sourcing these parts, you're sourcing absolutely the best parts from the best suppliers of the highest quality, the highest integrity. And if any of those parts go bad at any point, you know where they are, where they were used, and you can find them and replace them if necessary. What I will show you tonight, and what kind of scared me as I was doing this research, is the volume of what is being consumed is so enormous. If you have a manual process for managing open source, if you have a policy that you've tried to educate people on, if you have an open source review board that manages like what are we using in our organization, the chances are very large that you are completely outgunned. You are completely outgunned by the volume of what is being consumed.
So which tool are you using to analyze this? Which tool in the background to analyze all the code?
Yeah, so which tools are people using to analyze the code?
To come to your conclusion.
Yeah, so that actually comes as part of the conclusion. And there are, Sonatype has tools, but there are other tools like OWASP dependency check that do provide solutions to help you understand what open source components are you using. And I'll tell more about that toward the end as well. So that's a very good question. Anyone that has questions along the way, definitely please stop me and ask. But you've been outgunned for about 8 years, maybe 9 years. And as I said earlier, software development has changed significantly, but the processes that we have to keep up are not keeping up. I looked today to update this slide because it's constantly outdated, but we have 1,069,205 different components in the central repository. This is just Java components alone. If you look at Ruby gems and PHP and JavaScript and all the other components, the number of components that are available to developers for free is huge. The average, or the number of suppliers, is now 117,000 suppliers. We crossed 1 million components, I think, on July 6th, right? So we're now 2 months since then. We're almost, you know, we're leaning toward another 100,000 added. The growth rate on this is like 1,000 or 2,000 components being added a day. These are updated 3 or 4 times a year. Yes?
I have a question. How would you
Struts, Bouncy Castle, Spring Core, Spring Framework, any of these kind of...
The whole framework is as like a component, one component.
Yes, so the whole frame...
How about the budget on that?
So that is an application, not a component. The application may be built from multiple components, but the things like Tomcat or Docker or Nexus, open source applications are not in this repository. The parts or building blocks that are used to build those applications, like when we build our Nexus repository manager, we use open source components to build those.
Did you use any assessment scale, like how would you range most dangerous one?
So Sonatype doesn't, but there is the level of vulnerability scores, the CVSS scores that are common across all of these components. If there is a vulnerability that's been discovered, have a CVE identifier and a CVSS score from 1 to 10 on 10's the most vulnerable and 1 is the least vulnerable if they have vulnerabilities. So there is a huge number of parts and a huge supplier ecosystem available to software developers. If you're a large technology financial services company, there are probably a few in New York. I'm just guessing. Maybe you work for one. How many suppliers do you think your organization deals with? Because you don't use 117,000 software suppliers in your organization. But guesses for a t-shirt.
A.
Okay, who said B?
B.
Okay.
I already got one.
Okay, you got one. 2 in the back of the room. Okay, so B was the answer. When I looked at these different organizations, I found that you're using 7,600 different suppliers on average within your organization. By comparison, Chevy has 5,500 suppliers for all of their automobiles. Toyota, best-in-class manufacturer, has 224 suppliers. These are suppliers that you said, I don't want to build the software ourselves. We're going to go externally to these suppliers and get those. And from those suppliers, you've got 18,000 different versions of those parts from those suppliers that you brought into the organization. And you downloaded those on average 240,000 times. You liked them so much you just didn't want to download them once, you needed to download them like 15 times each. And there, anyone that's a developer understands there's a reason why you would want to download, different developers want to download their own things, so that makes sense to some extent. But it's certainly not efficient for downloading things from a central warehouse when you could put them all in the local warehouse and download them from there. Because like any other supply chain in the world, local warehouses are closer to where stuff is being produced and more efficient. So struts, bouncy castle, bash, poodle, Heartbleed, all the different logoed vulnerabilities that came out. You guys see this as much as I do. About once a month, I'm seeing some article somewhere that quotes the cathedral in the bazaar that says, with many eyeballs, all bugs are shallow. And when Poodle or Bash or whatever comes out, that blog appears like 8 times a day, right? With someone saying, open source is just as secure as closed source. Right, but it's dogma. It's just belief that, you know, I think it's safer or not as safe. So at Sonatype, we have 115,000 people developing open source that contribute to the repository and contribute updates to the repository for new features, bug fixes, higher performance, what have you. So we did an analysis of that. And what we found is that for the open source components and their dependencies, because components have other components that they depend upon, when there was a known vulnerability in that component or a dependency, it was only fixed 41% of the time. Even if a new version of the component was released, or many new versions of the component released, only 41% of projects ever fixed the known security documented vulnerability with those components and their dependencies, right? And the average time to repair was 390 days. So if you Google almost too big to fail, or I'm gonna give everyone the slides afterwards, and the link is in the slides, Dan Gere and Josh Corman wrote this article about this research to tell you, and this doesn't include how long it takes you to instrument the repair of the repaired piece within your applications inside your organizations. And the impact of this on the supply chain is not that, oh my gosh, things are vulnerable and there are bad parts, because we all know there are bad parts and there are good parts out there. But imagine when you're picking suppliers. Do you want to pick a supplier of software that has never repaired the vulnerabilities in their code? Or do you want to pick the suppliers that fixed their problems within 7 days of the CVE being being discovered or being announced.
Are you referring to Microsoft or Adobe? I get the two confused.
I'm sorry?
Are you referring to Microsoft or Adobe? I get the two confused all the time.
No one is safe within these bounds, but there are really good suppliers that have very good practices, and there are suppliers that don't have good practices. And at Sonatype, we believe, and as an industry, we believe, that there's an opportunity to make information like this available so that we can begin to figure out how to make better choices. If you don't have the facts, you can't make better choices. And part of sharing this research is we want people to make better choices and be informed and help us. I won't pretend that we have all the answers, right? But we're sharing information to allow ourselves as a community to be more intelligent about the answers that we provide. So in the world of open source, I mentioned there are tons of different, yes?
So that previous slide, in CVSS scores of 10?
Yes.
Yes,
so when it's a CVSS score of 10, the highest, the worst, it's an average of 240 days to repair for the open source project. Yes. 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 And that's, we analyzed 100,000. It was, the research was done last year, so it probably was somewhere just under 100,000 suppliers because the supplier base grows as well. Across, whether it's Java, Bower, CPAN, NPM components, Python components, the number of components are in the hundreds of thousands or tens of thousands across all of these different repositories. Modulecounts.com has this cool thing if you actually want to see the counts. Where we handled 17 billion download requests last year, NPM JavaScript related components had 15 billion downloads last year. Even the newer like .NET components from the NuGet gallery, this is really kind of only active for about 2 years now. They're doing 280 million downloads annually on average. So there is a huge volume of consumption out there within the industry. And your software developers, whatever languages they're developing in, consume those. One of the challenges that we have within the software supply chains is that unlike other supply chains where you know the suppliers and you know the sourcers and who's getting parts from those suppliers and you know what products those went into, an open source project that puts their components in a public repository has no idea who downloads those parts or what they were used in or where they were used. And when they actually release new versions, even if it's to fix a security flaw or just to introduce new features, they don't have a way to communicate to their installed base of whoever's used their stuff. They just put it out there and say, hey, there's a new version. And if you follow them on Twitter, you might see, hey, I just released blah, 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 version, you know, 8.4.1.1. But you know, if you use the component last year that worked for you, you can just continue using the same, that same component year over year, but there's no communication channel between these suppliers and these consumers of the parts. When we look at, another thing that I looked at was traffic patterns of consumption. How are organizations consuming these components? So the way to get components from these local repos, a number of tools, whether it's a browser or Maven build tool or Bamboo or Jenkins or any number of Puppet or Chef, any other tools, those tools can point to the central repository, request or any repositories and request components and pull them into the development pipeline or your software supply chain. And that is the long path to go and get those components because there are things called repository managers. Nexus is one of them that Sonatype makes, but there's Archiva and Artifactory are the other well-known ones. And these were put in place 8 years ago or 9 years ago. We developed these because the public repos would go down. Right? They weren't highly available like they are today. NuGet Gallery, it's newer, it's not highly available. It goes down like once a month. And when it does, the Twitterverse lights up of my builds are breaking because everyone's build tool is pointing there. They can't develop. They can't build. All of their builds fail when those repositories go down. So they said, well, that's totally, actually we said, that's totally inefficient. We shouldn't do that. We should have a local warehouse. So we built one, right? And then we made it available as an open source product. We built one so that you could store parts locally. And when you develop your components yourselves internally, but you don't want to share those with everyone in the world, right? You want a place to put those, so you put them in a local repository. And that's a lot more efficient within an organization. So another guess for, I think I have a question coming up here. Okay, so what percentage of components are sourced from public repositories? And that means, pattern one. What percentage of the traffic that we see is pattern one, not pattern two? Okay, who said C? You got it. Okay. There you go. So C, 95% are sourced directly from the central repository. Now, let's talk about impact. One is it's totally inefficient, right? It's actually, your build would run as a developer 10, 20 times faster if you source from the local repository. But as a security professional, do you know what this means?
Somebody could put fake code in there.
Someone could put fake code in there, but throw out just, you don't have to say who you're with. How many developers are in your organization? Who has less than 500? Who has more than 500? Right? Couple probably with more than 1,000, couple thousand developers. If you have 100 developers, or 500 developers, or 2,000 developers, do you know how many people you have in software procurement? About 100, or 500, or 2,000, right? This traffic represents your procurement department. 95% of what is being sourced is being sourced by anyone that designs software in your organization. As a security professional, the problem with that is you have no way to figure out who downloaded what within your organization. That is nearly impossible at the volumes of consumption to audit, to understand. If people were just going to the local warehouse to get their parts and only going this route for the parts that weren't in the local warehouse, right? Then as a security professional, you could look at this and say, do we have any bad parts in here, right? And if so, we maybe should think about not using them or what the use cases are for doing that. But this pattern makes things very unmanageable from a security perspective. Developers love it. They need a project, right? They pull it in when they need it. So. I'll just put a note in the meetup comments about this so you don't have to remember it, but you can write it down. There's something called repository health check from Sonatype. If you have a Nexus repository, it's free. It's a free feature. You just turn it on. I'll show you the link. But it will tell you, it will give you a report of every component in your repository, and if it has known vulnerabilities, it also tells you the versions of those components, what license types they are, what have you. But I figured I'd mention it just because it's a free service. I'll put it in the meetup notes so that you'll see the link to that. So as we go further down the software supply chain into the manufacturers, one of the things that I mentioned before is software developers want, and development organizations want to move faster and faster. The cool guys that are doing cool software development are heading toward more agile, more continuous, the DevOps instant kind of deployments, right? Where releases are thousands or hundreds a day, a month, what have you. And what they're seeing is they're trying to remove as many constraints from this process as possible to make them as efficient as possible, right? And when something doesn't fit, like a security test that takes 2 weeks or a month to get results back, developers don't like it. And they probably avoid it. Or we say, you know, we're not going to test every release to see what's in it. We'll just test like 1 out of 10. And we'll hope that we catch something. And then when we catch something as security professionals, and I was just talking to a group of developers last night when I was in Atlanta, and I said, like, how many of you like, you know, interacting with your security teams? And all of them, and maybe you guys as developers are like, yeah. Like the looks on their faces tell all, right? I don't like interacting with those. And when interacting with those teams, because they slow me down or they create rework for me. You weren't supposed to use that version, use this version, it's safer. Dude, I'm on to my latest sprint and I don't have time for that, and maybe we'll schedule it in the next sprint if we have time, but we have customer critical features that we need to bring in, and that, you know, like try and escalate it so that I, you know, I can fix it, or in other words, kind of go away. When I was here last year presenting an open source application security and development survey, I surveyed 3,100 IT developers or IT professionals, developers, mainly last year, and asked them in their organizations what percent of them had a policy in their organization about using using open source. So what percent of organizations didn't have a policy in place for open source components?
C.
Who said C? Okay, you're all wrong. Sorry. 43% of organizations said they do not have an open source policy. Right? So 57% have one in place. When you get to organizations that are big and more mature and have lots of resources, like you have over 500 developers, only about 64% of them have a policy in place at all. And that policy might be only don't use GPL licenses. It might not cover security at all. It might be a paper-based policy. It might be an open source review board. Those ideals that are totally outgunned. And then, when we look at the 57% that had open source policies, I said, do you follow your policy? Right? 68% said, we don't follow our policy. You know why? Because it's a pain in the, we're on video. So it's not friendly. It doesn't work at the speed that I work at. So I don't like following it. And I don't like the security team trying to interrupt the speed that we're working. And if it doesn't fit, we're not going to do it, right? You need to figure out a way to get your process to speed up with the times, to actually reflect the times. Because what we also found out, when I looked across these different companies, and we talked earlier about 240,000 downloads on average, 15,000 of them, on average, were vulnerable. It's like it works out, you know, roughly to about 1 in 20 of these components that are downloaded are known vulnerable. And they might not be vulnerable in every use case, but they have a CVE assigned to them. And when I went through and was doing this research, and this research is not friendly kind of research, because I look at these companies and what I get is not a pretty report. I get like a 1.4 million line spreadsheet of these downloads, and each line representing a download that tells me where it came from and what requested it and what version of component, the name of the component, and does it have a known vulnerability, and if yes, what's the CVE associated with that. And when I was looking at all these companies sitting in bed at night at 9 o'clock trying to figure out what was going on, I saw, who knows the simple construct for a CVE identifier? Right. Okay. So CVE dash 2015 dash like a 4-number identifier. Right. You get it. So when I was looking at these sheets, you know what I was seeing? CVE-2003-some-identifier. CVE-2006-some-identifier. And I wasn't seeing that like once. I was scrolling through pages and pages and pages, right? Three things scared me about that. You know what they were? Guesses. Three things. Old vulnerabilities. They were old. It's 12 years old, right? That's one of the things that scared me. What's the two others? So it's still, it's old vulnerabilities, right?
Not getting fixed.
Not getting fixed. Well, there might be fixes out there, but they're downloading the bad parts, right? So the thing, the two other things that scared me, right? CVE-2003 means the part was created in 2003 or before, right? There are probably 50 new versions of that part that are available that might be fixed or might not be fixed, right? But it's 12 years old and you're putting it in your software. Or it's 8 years old and you're putting it in your software. And the third thing that scared me was the volume of what was happening. If it was a one-off, I'd be like, yeah, you know, someone didn't know. But when it was like hundreds and thousands, it, you know, of lines in the spreadsheet, it worried me. I was like, I'm never using software from any company that develops software ever again. Because, so the 60, so when I look, I did the analysis and I figured 66% of these were 2013 or older for known vulnerabilities of what was being downloaded. If they were 2015 and you just didn't know or your policies didn't catch up, that might be more acceptable, but that was a little scary. Struts one, yes?
Is it possible
to remove older versions from the software? No, that is a good question. So is it possible to remove the old versions from the repository, right? No, that's not how the open source community works. Rule number one, never break a build. If that component is needed by someone, right, and it might be a case, you have an internal application that needs struts one, use it. You're not vulnerable to anyone but the insiders, right? But we're not going to stop it, and if you want to fix the vulnerability, you need the old part to be in place before you replace it with the good part that's available. So you can't remove components from any of the repositories. Struts 1, huge vulnerabilities in Struts 1, Struts 2. Struts 1 was discontinued like 5 or 6 years ago. There are like 12 major known vulnerabilities and like the high level vulnerabilities. So last year, in the 12 months last year, Struts 1 was downloaded 755,000 times. It's totally out of date, end of life, big warnings, don't use this. It's totally flawed and it's downloaded in droves. Bouncy Castle. Anyone know what Bouncy Castle is? Crypto library, right? I need secure communications inside my application for my application. There's private information in this application I don't want to share with anyone. CVSS score of 10. 7-8 years ago, right? It was fixed almost immediately. And last year, 42,000 people downloaded the vulnerable versions when the safer versions have been available, right? So the volume of what's out there and what's being consumed is quite large. So the other thing, yes? It's a great question. How much of this is for old code? I can't tell you. We can't see that. What we see is there are like 4,000 organizations downloading Bouncy Castle struts. There are like 20,000 organizations downloading it. There can't be that much old development going on in that volume. Yes.
I'm not a developer, so I don't know if this is on target, but isn't there a structure to this repository so that when I go in for a component, it's obvious to me that there's a better one than perhaps the one I'm selecting?
There is a structure if you go to the central repository and you look for struts, and you can see every version of struts that's available. But if you point your build tool toward the repository and say, give me the version of struts that I used last time, right, or the same version that we always use, you don't go and look what versions are available. You just pick the version that you know works or worked for you last time or all your buddies use, or it's kind of the standard in your team. So one of the things that I also saw within this report, it also deals with the efficiencies, is out of the top 100 components that were downloaded, these organizations were downloading 27 versions of their top 100 components. Right?
That's all the developers have in their own boxes.
Right? Okay, all the developers have their own boxes.
I'm
right?
Just saying as an example, although if they had a central repository.
I'm not saying it doesn't make sense, right? I'm not saying that I can't make sense of the behavior. But if you're at Google, there is a rule that you have to use one version of the components that are there. And you have a rule that you can ask for a waiver for a second version. But Google has one version of the components that they use. In the scenario that you were discussing, the designers have access to all these different versions of components. So if we're designing the 2016 Land Rover, I can pick as a designer from any of 27 different mufflers that we've used on a Land Rover over the last 15 years, even if they're known defective, and put them in the 2016 model year, right? That clearly doesn't happen, right, in any other manufacturing industry. But in software development, it happens in a large scale. So we assess different applications, and there's a free service I'll tell you about that does this, where we look at, across these number of applications, there are on average about 100 components in an application. 23% of those components are known vulnerable within the analysis that we've done. Veracode did a similar analysis across 5,000 applications and found about the same number, like 24 known vulnerabilities in the application. It was like 24 or 25, but somewhere around the same component. So we all saw the Wired article about the Jeep being stopped on the highway and the truck coming up behind the driver. And the big hoopla around Black Hat DEF CON over the summer. But the interesting thing about this is we all know that Chrysler made a recall for those vehicles, and every vehicle using that software, right, within the week of that Wired article going out, and they knew about the research that had happened before, and they knew every single vehicle that used that software, every make and model that used that software. And do you know why? They have a fully managed end-to-end supply chain. Every nut and bolt and piece of software and steering wheel and gear shift knob and whatever in every application is known to them. And they could communicate to everyone that had those, there is an issue. And when there's E. coli and beef in some, you know, slaughterhouse somewhere that they find, isn't it cool and nice to know that when you turn on the news in the morning and they say this ground beef, like 20 million pounds of it, with this serial number is being recalled, and the grocery stores all know it, and they look for those barcodes and they pull it off the shelf so that we don't get sick, right? Ground beef is actually more advanced in their supply chains than software. So they have to be. Right? They have no choice. They're mandated. Which gets to, in December last year, the U.S. Congress introduced legislation that they will reintroduce for consideration again in the next couple of weeks, we believe, led by a consortium of different people but Ed Royce from California, Len Jenkins from Kansas, that says, if you sell software to the federal government, we want you to do three things. One, give us a bill of materials for all of the open source and third-party components that are in this software. We want to know the ingredients, right? What's in it? Number two, if there are known vulnerabilities in that software, in those software components, you need to fix them before we will buy this software, right? We're not going to buy known defective stuff and put it into government systems and DOD systems and IRS systems and anything else that are out there across the government. And number three is, if any component ever goes bad, because components can age more like milk than wine. If any component ever goes bad, then you have to make sure that that is patchable, right? And why is the government interested in doing this? They don't want to buy vulnerable software, and they want to make sure it's fixable if it's vulnerable, and they've managed to get every other modern manufacturing industry to apply standards to how they build stuff so that it's safe for the consumers to use. Right? The labels on food, we know what's in it. We know what's in the things that that we're consuming. So I'm gonna wrap this up because I know we're I'm running a little over. But the way to solve this, we firmly believe this is only solvable. The only way to solve this is through developers. Application security and other teams will play a role. Governance teams and audit teams will play a role in helping to define the policies. But the ones to actually fix the problem will be the developers. Why? They're the ones that are consuming the parts, right? No one else judges what parts we need and need to consume in the organization. And if we're going to have them as the source to solve this problem, we need to get them the right information at the right time, and it needs to be frictionless. The information needs to be instantaneous. It needs to be automated. So when a developer says, I want part A, they immediately know, is part A good or bad? And then we want to create a software bill of materials so we know what we put in our goods so that we can track and trace those across the organization. So this is the quick, at the end, I have to do a show you something that helps solve this problem. But Faircode, I know, has solutions in their application security portfolio. HP in their Fortify portfolio also has solutions. They happen to come from Sonatype because we offer them to HP. Sonatype offers these. The OWASP dependency check is a solution that fits into this space. Some of those solutions are free. The Sonatype and OWASP offerings are both free of charge services. But there are ways that we actually construct and automate a policy to say, if a component, any component, comes in to our environment where we have monitoring points that has a CVSS between 4 and 7, alert someone, block it, fail the build, do something, monitor it, or keep track of that, so that the policies are easy to set. When you're a developer and you're using a tool like Jenkins or Bamboo or Team City or Hudson, and you're running those integrations, you see whether the builds are stable or whether they fail, then you also can see at the same time what components are in that and what the quality and integrity of those components is. In this effort to scan an application might take 30 seconds, might take a minute. It doesn't add significant time. When you're a developer and you're picking components, right, we can show you, here's the component that you selected. These, all the verticals, are every component version that's available. This happens to be the most popular component being downloaded today. And it has an acceptable license type, and it has fewer red and yellow marks, which means it has fewer known vulnerabilities associated with it. When you're a developer and you select a part, if you know instantly this part is bad and doesn't meet my policy, but this part is more acceptable or perhaps has no known vulnerabilities, you can make an easy decision to say, I'm going to use the better part. And it helps remove rework from down the line problems that are discovered and helps you be more efficient. I'll give everyone the slides after the presentation. I'll tell you how to get them instantly. There is this link that gets you to the application health check, which creates a full bill of materials. This is similar to the OWASP dependency check. I'll say I think our information is a lot better, but you can compare them for yourself. If you don't want to scan your own application, pick any open source application that your organization uses and scan that to get an example of how it works. My email address is weeks@sonotype.com. If you email me right now, my out of office is set. It has three links in it. One is to the presentation. It's on SlideShare. You can download it. One is to the detailed 30-page report that has more information than what I shared here that you can download. And the third link is for, and you don't have to put a subject line or anything like, hey, Derek, it was nice meeting you. Just weeks at Sonotype and you'll get the out of office response. And the third one is the open source survey that we ran last year and the slides that were available for that. So you'll get all three in the out of office as long as my out of office is up today. So that's it. I'm sorry I ran a little bit over, but hopefully, you know, what I wanted to do was give information to help start the conversation. Right, there are some solutions out there, but we don't have all the solutions today. And as security professionals, when you see these problems, if you can help solve some of those problems, we welcome the OWASP community to contribute toward that. So thank you very much.